Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chansong. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Wednesday, the 28th of January. India begins COVID-19 vaccine exports, first doses in Bhutan, Maldives. Afghan government will not release more Taliban prisoners, says President's media advisor Wahid Omer. And Sikh devotees across India mark birth anniversary of spiritual leader with prayers. And now for all the details. India started exporting coronavirus shots to its neighbours on Wednesday with a shipment to the Himalayan Kingdom of Bhutan followed by Maldives as the so-called pharmacy of the world looks to bolster its vaccine diplomacy. Bhutan received 150,000 Indian-made coronavirus vaccines on Wednesday morning and Maldives received 100,000 in the afternoon.
Bhutan and the Maldives on Wednesday became the first countries in India's neighborhood to be provided with COVID-19 vaccines under a grant assistance program dubbed Vaccine Maitri or Vaccine Friendship as New Delhi looks to bolster its vaccine diplomacy. India's Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar took to Twitter and called it another example of neighborhood first. Bhutan received 150,000 Indian-made coronavirus vaccines on Wednesday morning and Maldives received 100,000 in the afternoon. Many low- and middle-income countries are relying on India, the world's biggest vaccine maker, for supplies to start COVID-19 immunization programs and bring an end to their outbreaks. India's foreign ministry said on Tuesday, supplies under grant assistance would be shipped to the Maldives, Bangladesh, Nepal, Myanmar and the Seychelles, while Sri Lanka, Afghanistan and Mauritius await regulatory clearances to receive the vaccines. On Thursday, Bangladesh and Nepal will get their first consignment, while Myanmar and Seychelles will receive the vaccines on Friday. India initially will only ship the AstraZeneca vaccine made by the Serum Institute of India, the world's biggest vaccine maker, which brands the shot as Covishield. Meanwhile, India's active coronavirus cases tally dropped below 200,000 after 6 months and 24 days, according to the Health Ministry. India has so far vaccinated more than 631,417 frontline workers. The world's second most populous country reported on Wednesday 13,823 new cases, taking the total to 10.9 million.
Moving on, senior advisor of Afghan President Ashraf Ghani, Wahid Omer, has said the Afghan government will not release more Taliban prisoners. Omer said previous releases have resulted in more violence in the country. The remark comes as the Taliban has made more demands amid the ongoing peace talks in Doha, including release of its 7,000 more fighters.
Afghanistan President Ashraf Ghani's senior advisor for public and strategic affairs, Wahid Omer, has said that the Afghan government will not release more Taliban prisoners and that previous releases has resulted in more violence. This comes as the Taliban has demanded the release of 7,000 more prisoners, the removal of group's members from the UN blacklist and the formation of an Islamic system in order to continue the peace talks. The release of over 5,000 Taliban prisoners before was intended to reduce violence as part of the peace process, but violence has increased because of it, the official said. Over the past weekend, the chief negotiators from the Afghan government and the Taliban met in Doha. However, the working groups from both sides failed to meet on Monday to finalize the agenda for the peace talks. Earlier this week, the US Department of Defense, in a statement, confirmed that the number of US forces in Afghanistan has been reduced to 2,500 as agreed in US-Taliban agreement last year. A Taliban spokesman, Mohammad Naeem, welcomed the move as a step forward toward resolving the conflict in Afghanistan. The US-Taliban deal signed on February 29 last year raised hopes among Afghans for a reduction in violence, but the Taliban continued their attacks against the Afghan government forces.
More news from Afghanistan. Targeted killings of journalists, government officials and rights activists have increased rapidly in recent months as violence surges in Afghanistan despite peace talks between the government and the Taliban. On Tuesday, a bomb hit a civilian vehicle near the southern Uruzgan province, while another one exploded in Kabul's 4th district.
One police officer was killed and several people, including a local radio journalist, were wounded in a motorcycle bomb blast in Terrencote, capital of Afghanistan's southern Uruzgan province, on Tuesday, the provincial governor confirmed. According to Governor Mohammad Omar Shirzad, the explosion occurred when an improvised bomb attached to a motorcycle was detonated at midday when highway police vehicles were passing by the area. The wounded were transported to a nearby hospital, Shirzad said, blaming the Taliban militant group for the attack. Violence in Afghanistan has increased in recent days, including targeted killings of journalists, government officials and rights activists in cities including capital Kabul. In the latest, two female judges were killed by unknown gunmen in the Afghan capital on Sunday. Reports suggest that at least 9 provinces in Afghanistan have witnessed targeted attacks, explosions and violent criminal acts in the past 48 hours.
In news from Pakistan, Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz's Vice President Maryam Nawaz has lashed out at Prime Minister Imran Khan, calling him the biggest thief and termed his Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf's foreign funding case the biggest fraud in Pakistan's history. The remarks were made during opposition Pakistan Democratic Movement's anti-government rally on Tuesday held outside the Election Commission of Pakistan.
Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz or PMLN's Vice President Maryam Nawaz has lashed out at Prime Minister Imran Khan, calling him the biggest thief and termed the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf foreign funding case the biggest fraud in Pakistan's history. Addressing a gathering outside the Election Commission of Pakistan on Tuesday, Maryam said the cases against her father, former Premier Nawaz Sharif, were expedited and decided within days, but the Election Commission had held 70 hearings of the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf case since 2014. The foreign funding case against Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf was filed in November 2014 by Akbar S. Babar, a founding member of the party. He had alleged serious financial irregularities in the party's accounts.
23 bank accounts, so jo State Bank of Pakistan hai, usne pakad liye iske. Aur ye 23 bank accounts is Imran Khan ke dastakhaton ke saath operate ho rahe the. Ye nahi ki inko pata nahi tha, jaan boojh ke Pakistan ki awam se aur ECP se apna jurm chupaya inhone. और स्क्रूटनी कमेटी खुद ये इतराफ करती है कि ये हकायक हम आपको फराहम नहीं कर सकते क्योंकि इमरान खान ने मना किया है. मेरे भाइयों, अब पता चला कि चोर 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 की गिरदान करने वाला खुद सबसे बड़ा चोर निकला.
The Pakistan Democratic Movement, the anti-government alliance of the opposition, on Tuesday gathered outside the Election Commission of Pakistan to remind it of its constitutional obligations. It was PDM's first show of power in Islamabad against Imran Khan-led government.
Moving on, Pakistan-administered Kashmir is all set for elections to the Legislative Assembly this year. The Election Commission of Pakistan-administered Kashmir has announced the schedule for preparation and update of list of voters residing within the territory. Unveiling the scheme for the 33 constituencies, Chief Election Commissioner retired Justice Abdul Rashid Sulariya in a news conference recently gave the details of electoral rolls, which will be verified by the National Database and Registration Authority and would be published on February 23. The final list of 33 constituencies will be published on April 1. Pakistan-administered Kashmir, which was illegally annexed by Islamabad more than 7 decades ago, is one of the most underdeveloped regions. Residents of Indian village of Kamala Harris celebrated her inauguration as U.S. Vice President on Wednesday by offering prayers and setting off firecrackers. The village in southern India is where Harris' maternal grandfather was born more than a century ago.
Residents of the ancestral Indian village of Kamala Harris celebrated her inauguration as U.S. Vice President on Wednesday by offering prayers and setting off firecrackers. Thulasendrampuram, a leafy village about 200 miles south of the city of Chennai, is where Harris's maternal grandfather was born more than a century ago. Harris, who was born to an Indian mother and a Jamaican father, both of whom immigrated to the United States to study, visited Thulasendrampuram when she was 5, and she recalled walks with her grandfather on the beach at Chennai.
Hopefully, we are very much happy to. We are also ready to celebrate that occasion. Sir. Yeah, she is the first maybe vice president U.S. here. In India, everybody know, but if it is U.S. here, this is a powerful country. So they are all the decision makers all over fields. So she is the number one inspiration. Sir.
She has done all on her own. All that I will tell her. So far, she has been telling her mother, taught her everything. I said, do whatever Shamla taught you. Do that way. You have been doing fine so far. Keep it up. That's all I can say.
Meanwhile, Indian sand artist Sudarshan Patnaik carved a sand sculpture of U.S. President-elect Joe Biden and Vice President-elect Kamala Harris on Tuesday to congratulate them on the new administration's inauguration. Patnaik created the sand art in India's Eastern Puri beach depicting Biden and Harris's faces mounted in front of the American flag and the U.S. Capitol building.
Sikh devotees on Wednesday offered prayers and took holy dips at the famous Golden Temple in India's northern Amritsar city to mark the birth anniversary of their 10th religious leader, Guru Gobind Singh. Devotees in national capital New Delhi also carried out a procession to mark the auspicious occasion and seek blessings. Devotees in India's northern Amritsar city visited the holiest shrine of Sikhism, the Golden Temple, on Wednesday to offer prayers on the birth anniversary of their 10th religious leader, Guru Gobind Singh. Guru Gobind Singh is the 10th Sikh Guru, a warrior, poet, philosopher, and the son of the revered 9th Sikh Guru Tegh Bahadur, who founded the Sikh warrior community Khalsa in the late 17th century. Devotees performed special prayers and took bath in the sacred pond as they remembered the spiritual leader on his birth anniversary.
Aj sahibe kamal tan tan sahib shri guru gobind singh ji da prakash purv hai ji te sariyan sangtan aj ral ke harmandir sahib de vich unna par patshah da dihada mana rahiyan ne te mere vallon samooh sangat nu sare jagat nu lakh lakh vadhaiyan ji guru maharaj de purv diyan te patshah ise tarah kripa karan.
Similar scenes were witnessed in capital New Delhi, where devotees carried out a procession to mark the auspicious occasion and seek blessings.
हम तो यही कहेंगे कि पूरे वर्ल्ड से ये कोरोना जाना चाहिए, सबको शांति दे परमात्मा, इस रोग को दूर करे. हम तो यही अरदास करेंगे परमात्मा के आगे.
Sikhs in India form about 2% of over 1.35 billion population and are largely concentrated in the northern Indian state of Punjab and national capital New Delhi. Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/asianewsline and follow us on Twitter at @asianewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.